Today, we're going to be talking about subsurface imaging. But first, let's talk about why. Why do we want subsurface imaging? So we could use subsurface imaging to find mineral deposits or to find geothermal reservoirs to heat our homes. We can use it to find natural gas and oil, or we can use it to store CO2, or even to build houses where we couldn't before because we now have such a clear image of the subsurface. In short, there are many applications for subsurface imaging. And in the geophysical world, which is a world full of optimization problems, there is an ever-increasing need for computation time. And that is exactly where quantum annealing comes in. And not only does this work show yet another application for the D-wave machines, it also shows a possible solution to the computational problems that geophysicists face. Good day, everybody. I am Stan van der Linde, an applied mathematician. And for my master thesis at the TU Delft, I have explored quantum annealing for subsurface imaging. And I did that in cooperation with TNO and Aramco. So let's look what I've got in store for you today. First of all, I'm going to give you a crash course into subsurface imaging. For that, I'm going to use a simplified model, which I'm going to use to explain subsurface imaging and some of the problems that arise during it. Next, we will go into the method where I will explain two binary quadratic models we got. Here, I will scare you with a little bit of mathematics. And next, we will move on to the results. And I will explain to you why it is so amazing that we go from the picture on the left to the picture on the right. Lastly, we'll go into the conclusion and outlook and look at the promising future of this work. So every seismic image starts with a seismic experiment. So let's take a look at one. Here we see the subsurface. It's a simplified version of that. The blue part's the sky and the brown areas that are the subsurface. And on top of that, we're going to put a seismic vibrator. Here depicted as the green car on the left. On the right, we're going to put geophones. These are going to record the signal. Well, this car will go vibrate and waves will start propagating through the earth. And they will move in this way. They will propagate through the earth until they encounter a subsurface interface where these two brown areas meet. And then they will reflect and they will be picked up by the geophones. Next, we will move the car. We redo the experiment. We move the car again. And we do the experiment again and again. And in this way, we gather lots and lots of data. But what does this data actually look like? So here I've drawn another seismic experiment, but with one card and one receiver. And on the left, I'm going to show the data that we get. Well, when this car now moves, the first subsurface interface will give a wave in the data. You can see that on the left. And a little bit later, the one from the, well, the second subsurface interface will be present. And next, the third one. And in this way, we get a nice wave for every subsurface layer. And you can see that here on the left. The signal on the left is what's called a trace. And what is very important is that this trace is actually in the time domain, whereas the depth of the Earth is, of course, in the distance domain. And there are some well-established ways to go from this time domain to the distance domain. However, there's one notoriously difficult part, which I haven't shown you yet, which is called the near surface. So here I've shown the first seismic experiment again, but I'm going to make it a little bit more realistic. I'm adding the near surface, and maybe it reminds you a little bit of what the Earth actually looks like, because of course it isn't really flat, right? Well, and this near surface causes all kinds of problems, because when we now start vibrating the Earth, the waves propagate a little bit differently. They propagate almost vertically there. And they move very slow compared to the other layers. And what this basically means is that the whole trace that we get is shifted by a tiny amount. And this can also happen because of some salt deposits or some caves. And these all shift the whole trace by a tiny amount, and that is called a static. And this might seem like a small problem. However, because the waves move so slowly through this near surface, even when it's very thin, it can have a substantial result on the final image. So how are we going to resolve this problem? For that, we're going to use what's called a midpoint getter. And here I've shown all the traces again from the first experiment. And we're going to select just a few of them. these all have the same midpoint. And because of that, they also reflect off the same area below the surface. So this subsurface interface should be visible in all of these traces. And when we correct for these different angles that these traces have, they should look exactly the same, except for the statics that the near surface is giving us. So how are we going to use that information? Well, here I've shown two traces again, and they are exactly the same, except for this little shift. And remember, these waves are actually what are these subsurface interfaces. When I now add these together to make what is called a stack, I get six waves, and they have a rather small amplitude. But when I correct for the static and I add them together, I get this trace. And this stack actually has a much larger amplitude, and you can see that there are only three interfaces, as we would expect. But we are really looking into these really large amplitudes. They say, well, this solution is correct. And it might seem like an easy problem, but it's actually a very difficult problem. It's a highly multimodal problem, which is very difficult to solve. And this is just for true traces. I've shown the objective function right here. But you can imagine that when you use hundreds of traces, it gets even more difficult. And not only is it a difficult problem, it's also a very big problem. So one of the solutions I'm going to show you, we have 108 traces with 15 possible shifts, and that will amount to roughly 10 to the power 126 different combinations. And you can see that this cute picture on the right quickly becomes a really large monster. And just to give you an idea of how large that number actually is, well, the number of particles in the observable universe is estimated to be roughly 10 to the power 82. And you can see that this is, yeah, well, not even close to this, to the problems we are trying to solve. And it's getting even worse than that, because when you make a combinatorial problem of this, it's actually an NP-hard problem. So it's a very big, very difficult problem. Nonetheless, because it's a very important problem, people have tried to solve it. And for that, right now, the state-of-the-art solvers are nature-inspired global solvers, like the Firefly algorithm or the Willswarm optimization. And in the past, simulated annealing has been used to solve this problem. The downside is, however, is that these are very expensive methods. And, well, they don't find the global optimum all the time. And it's very important that we find it and not some other local optimum that's very far away in solution space. To try to overcome these problems, we are looking into quantum annealing right now. And I'm going to into how are we actually going to use quantum annealing. Well, first of all, I'm going to show you the classical optimization problem. And for that, I will need some notation. So here you see a trace, and I'm going to denote that with a D subscript I, where the D stands for data. When I now move this trace by a static of tau I like this, I will now call this trace DI tau I. What we then do is we take lots of these traces, we sum them, and then we take the squared Euclidean norm, and we maximize over that. And what this basically does, it really emphasizes really large amplitudes, and that is exactly what we wanted. However, this cannot be run on the D-wave quantum annealers right now because, well, they can't handle these shifts, and they can't calculate this Euclidean norm, and they can't handle these combinatorial optimization problems like this. So we need to make a binary quadratic model of this. And to do that, we use two different kinds of encoding. We encoded the traces in the following way. So here you see a trace. And then we made some copies of that. And each copy has a little bit of a different shift. And we encoded that in two ways, with a one-hot encoding and with a binary encoding. And what we then did is we substituted these encodings into the previous objective function. And when you write out the math really nicely, you basically get this binary quadratic model. So this is the binary quadratic model when we use a one-hot encoding. And what I want to focus on is actually these variables right here, these XIA and XJB. These actually enforce this one-hot encoding. However, it is now still possible that some traces are not selected at all or multiple times, and that's not what we want. So we added a penalty term, and this now makes the objective function so that it favors solutions that actually enforce this one-hot encoding. We did basically the same for the binary encoding, and that resulted in the following model. It looks very similar. However, instead of these variables, XIA and XJB, we now have these functions. And these functions are actually higher degree polynomials, which enforce these binary encodings. However, this gives us a higher order model, but we need a quadratic model for the D-Wave machines. So for that, we used pairwise degree reduction provided by D-Wave. It's just one line of code. It's really easy to implement. But why would we do all this extra effort for this binary encoding? Well, basically because it always gives a meaningful result. It can never happen that we select a trace multiple times or not at all. That's very nice. But what I want you to take away from this method section mostly is that we actually have two binary quadratic models. We have a binary encoding model and a one-hot encoding model. And with that said, let's move on to the results. So first of all, I'm going to show you a proof of concept. And I will do this for two reasons, to make you more familiar with the type of results and just to show you how the algorithm works. So here on the right, I've shown two traces, just like I've shown you before. We have the time going down and the amplitude of the waves is in the left and right. Now we're going to sort of look at that from the top, and that's called a getter. I've shown that on the left. And these are actually exactly the same data. So on the left, you see two traces. And when an area is very light, it means that the amplitude is very large, whereas the darker it gets, the lower the amplitude. I'm also going to show you what the stack looks like. That's on the right. It's sort of the average of these waves. And you can see right here that this stack now contains, well, two waves. However, they bounce off the same area, so they should only have, well, one wave. So that's what we're looking for, perfectly aligned and one wave. What we then did is we gave this to the D-Wave quantum annealers with both the binary encoding and the one-hot encoding. And they actually gave exactly the same result, so I'm only going to show it once. And we get this output. And what you can see on the left is that the getter is perfectly aligned. And on the right, you can see that there is exactly one trace and there's one subsurface interface. So we found the perfect solution. Next, we gave a little bit more difficult problem. So here you see 16 traces, four possible shifts, and a lot more subsurface interfaces. What we then did is we gave this to the D-Wave quantum annealers with a one-hot encoding, and that gave the following result. And what you see right here is that there is almost perfect alignment, except for trace 8. Overall, we're pretty happy with this result, but we really would like to see the global optimum. But, well, this solution is also very close in solution space, so we're also pretty happy with this one. But we also did the same with the binary encoding. You can see the result right here. And here you actually see this perfect alignment, right? This is exactly what we want. And just to compare them side by side, I've shown here the stacks, so the average of them. So here's the stack of the input trace, the stack of the one hot correction, and the stack of the binary correction. So what you can see is that there are really a large improvement with the one hot and binary correction, but it's pretty difficult to see the difference between them. So here I've plotted the difference between the optimal solution and the one hot stack on the left, and on the right, the difference between the optimal solution and the binary stack. And well, since the binary stack found the optimal solution, it's centered around zero, whereas for the one hot stack, it didn't find that. And you see these, well, small wiggles, and they might seem like small errors, but they can give a substantial error on the final image. So the one on the right is actually a lot better than the one on the left. What we did next is we tried to look at even larger problems. And by larger problems, I mean either a larger number of traces or a larger number of shifts. However, when we tried that, even when we can encode it on the D-Wave quantum annealers, it gave bad convergence. And we're looking into solving this problem. But in the meanwhile, we have also looked at another possible solution, the hybrid solver. And the D-Wave hybrid solver can actually solve much, much larger problems. And we did that. We gave it a much larger problem, but also a much more difficult problem. So for that, we used the ARIT model. It's a 3D subsurface imaging model. It's sort of like the zebra fish set from machine learning. It's very difficult and very realistic, and people basically use this to break their code on. and this is what we actually gave to the hybrid model. This is the, well, input we gave it. We see here 108 traces, and you see that they're very much misaligned. And we will give it 15 possible shifts. And that is actually that huge number that I was talking about earlier, that the number of combinations is much larger than the particles in the universe. But before we go into what the hybrid solver actually got, we're going to look at what a industry standard solver would get. So here I've shown the industry standard solver results. This is a cross-correlation deterministic solver. And what you can still see is that the most left traces are still very much misaligned, and some in the middle are also not aligned. However, when we gave it to the hybrid solver, we actually got this output. And you now see that there is almost no misalignment. So this is actually a lot better compared to, well, the current industry standard. Just to give you a comparison, we're going to look at the stacks again, side by side. So here is the stack of the input on the left. And in the middle, you see the stack of the deterministic correction. And what you can see is that around 0.25 seconds, we actually have much larger amplitudes, and we can actually distinguish these different waves where they are very hard to distinguish from noise before. But when we give it to the hybrid correction, you can see that this is even more. So the amplitudes are even larger, and it's even more clear where these subsurface interfaces are. So we're very happy with these results. And after these promising results, it's time to conclude and look at the outlook. So I've given you a crash course into subsurface imaging. I've shown you two binary quadratic models that can run on the quantum annealers to solve this problem. And I've shown you different inputs and results based on these models. And what I've actually shown you is the first of its kind implementation of a quantum annealing algorithm for subsurface imaging. We determined a maximum problem size of the current QPU approach. But right now, the hybrid solver already resolved this problem. Because of that, we would say that the future is very exciting and very promising in this field. I want to thank you for your time. I've been Stan van der Linde, and I hope you enjoyed this presentation. Thank you.